crown prince and princess get to sit down in the presence of the queen, but we don't. Jesus sits down in the presence of the majesty of heaven. And so he became much more superior to the angels, as his name is. Now that launches us into the rest of the letter, but I want to pause for a moment and think about the rest of verse 3. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down. Now it's true that this is an indication that Jesus is big and important and powerful, but it also means something else. It means he's finished. You don't sit down until you finish your job. He's done with purification for sins. The job is complete. And so I say to you, do you consider it a done deal? Do you really understand how complete the job is? Do you get that Jesus has finished his job of making you right with God? The cross has done it all. It's finished. It's kaput. When Jesus is hanging on the cross, one of the things that he cries out after he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Is it's finished. It's done. There is no more to do, ever. Now, everything that we do is a response to that, not a making of that, not an earning of that. It is all done. Over the next few weeks, as we unpack the book of Hebrews, I've got to say that we're going to see some contrasts with a very large church on the planet. And I'm not going to hold my punches back. So the idea that someone can say, I give you forgiveness for sins, other than Jesus, doesn't wash with this. The idea that there is still payment to be made for our sin does not wash with Hebrews 1, verse 3. Moving on. See, if Christian faith... Sorry, done that. Before we end, though, I want to give you a little preview of the weeks to come. Okay? There's a lot here. The fourth verse already hints as to what's next. Jesus is better than angels. We'll find out that he's better than Moses, that he's better than the law, that he has a priesthood which is better than the Levitical priesthood, and that as a great high priest, he offers a sacrifice better than any sacrifice that has ever been offered. Now, how should we respond to this Jesus? Well, by faith. And chapter 11 gives us some great examples of faith and what that faith looks like. And chapters 12 and 13 show us how we should live our lives with that faith. If you wanted to summarize the book of Hebrews in one sentence, it would be, Jesus is better than anything that has ever come before, and we should put our trust in him to forgive our sins, deal with our punishment, and show us how to live. So what do we do now? Well, there's the response to the fact that Jesus has sat down in the presence of the Father. Respond then. Put your trust in Jesus. But also, I want you to see what is said about Jesus. He is the communication of God. Christ is God's word to us. Boom. God has spoken to us in Jesus. What does God have to say? Look to Jesus. What does God think? Ask Jesus. And so for us to listen to God, we need to read the Word of God. Now I know some of you guys are busy and blah, 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 blah. No one is that busy. No one is that busy that they cannot sit down and read the Word of God. Set a time and read some Bible. If you don't read your Bible regularly, I know some of you don't, read three verses. I've given you a challenge, if I've got you on Facebook with it, read the book of Hebrews in a week. Okay? It's not that hard. It is literally 6 or 7 minutes. But read and stop making excuses. Oh, I was really tired. Oh, I've got the HSC. Oh, the one excuse I'll accept is I was dead, and in which case you won't be talking to me, but talking to Jesus. Okay? Because this, now, we've already been put to shame. Someone has read the Bible in 5 months. That's just epic. Now, you know, she's not working, etc., etc., but still, 5 months. What about us? Are we going to be people who go, oh man, I'm on my iPad, I'm just busy, and I have my phone games, and or are we going to be people who go, you know what, I just, every time I read, I get more, and I get more, and I get more. We had a guy come and looking after DV's battery because it went flat a few weeks ago. And he asked, he said, have you read the whole Bible? I said, oh yeah, I've read the whole Bible. Wow. I said, I've read it 3 or 4 times, maybe 5. And he went, wow. And I went, every time I read it, I get something new. Something more comes out. Because it's the communication of God. And God is not simple like you or me. When God speaks, you'll listen to it again and you go, I didn't see that. You guys ever watched a movie?
It's like an onion.
Have you ever watched a movie and gone a second time? She's watched movies, relax. Second time or third time, you go, I didn't see that the first time. The Word of God is like that. There'll be times you'll go, I never saw that. I have been sitting reading the Bible saying, I know I have read this verse before, but I never saw that. And I suspect that as I continue to read the Bible over the next 50 or 60 years or however long God gives me, I will still be finding new things that I did not notice. Not because I'm inattentive, but because this is God speaking to us. Any questions? Jean!
Verse 4.
Verse 4, what a surprise. Now, reiterate your question for me so I can remember.
Okay. So, the keyword that I got confused of is inherited. So, what is the name that Jesus inherited, and how did he inherit the name?
Okay. It's good I've got backup tonight. when this question's been asked in the past of someone much more knowledgeable than I think the name is, if you think of Philippians 2, the name is the Lord. And in Philippians 2, he inherits that name because he submits to the cross. So come with me to Philippians 2. I know it's jumping around the Bible. So verse 5, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of the servant, and being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, and death on the cross. Therefore God exalted him to the highest, don't sing it, to the highest place, gave him the name that is above every name. Okay, so at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven on earth and on the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Jesus.
Now, our issue is we've got Hebrew, Greek, Aramaic, English, and whatever we speak mixed in here. So when you look at the Old Testament, when the name of God comes up, if you were a Jewish person reading Hebrew scriptures in church, in synagogue, you'd get to God's name and you'd say, you wouldn't say the pronunciation of it, you would say Adonai. Because they don't want to break the fourth commandment, you know, third commandment, do not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Don't want to misuse it, so they don't say it. And so they say, Lord. Adonai, Lord. And so in our English Bibles, we have capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, when the name of God appears. Interesting thing is, in the Greek translation, I'm sorry about all the language, guys, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, when you get to the name of God, it says Kurios, which is the Greek word for sir or master or lord. Okay, and so when the New Testament references the Old Testament, sometimes when you see Kyrios, which is Lord, but only capital L because it's just Lord, sometimes that means Sir or Master, but sometimes it is referring to the name of God, which closest translation we would say would be something like Yahweh, right? So, when Paul says that Jesus Christ is Lord, I think he's saying that Jesus Christ is Yahweh, that he is the Lord. And so in Hebrews, the name that he has inherited is, I think, the Lord. It's a very long answer to a very short question. Does that make sense?
Yep. So.
And then he gets that name because he submits to the plan of dying on the cross.
So if he didn't, then he wouldn't be Yahweh.
I'm sure that's heresy. but we don't need to question because he did.
Okay.
So, you know, what if Jesus sinned?
Or failed.
Yeah. It's, the universe goes, oh, I'm sorry, I can't deal with that. Any other questions? Yes?
We were saying the statement of faith.
Yes?
With one bit, it says, blah, 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 scorn, it's shame. So.
Yes.
Does that mean he, like, scorn as in made fool of? It's shame, or?
No, he did not regard the shame of the cross as reason to not do it. Okay. That's what it means by he scorned the shame of the cross. Because remember that the cross, horrific way to die, terribly painful, but also shameful. You're hung naked on a tree, which in Jewish terms is cursed. Okay, so there's the curse as well as the pain. And so Jesus goes to the cross fully aware of the shame of the nature of his death, but goes, that's not a reason why I'm not going to do it. So he's, that's what it means.